Good morning. Welcome to worship on this eighth Sunday after Pentecost. It's good to be with you in God's house. Just a couple quick announcements. Just a reminder that next week, church, our only service on Sunday morning will be at 10 a.m. over in the dwelling place. So you can come here at 8:30, but you'll be, I won't be here. So. Also, you can check in the news and notes. Our lunch and learn is returning this week, so you can look in the news and notes for information regarding that. With that, why don't we go ahead and rise and greet one another before we sing our opening hymn. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner,
confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death,
upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in this stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We chant responsibly the intro.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O Lord, grant us wisdom to recognize the treasures you have stored up for us in heaven, that we may never despair but always rejoice and be thankful for the riches of your grace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our Old Testament reading for today is from Ecclesiastes chapters 1 and 2. Vanity of vanities, says the preacher, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. I, the preacher, have been king over Israel and Jerusalem, and I applied my heart to seek and to search out by wisdom all that is done under heaven. It is an unhappy business that God has given to the children of man to be busy with. I have seen everything that is done under the sun, and behold, all is vanity. And is striving after the wind. I hated all my toil in which I toil under the sun, seeing that I must leave it to the man who will come after me, and who knows whether he will be wise or a fool. Yet he will be master of all for which I toiled and used my wisdom under the sun. This also is vanity. So I turned about and gave my heart up to despair over all the toil of my labors under the sun. Because sometimes a person who has toiled with wisdom and knowledge and skill must leave everything to be enjoyed by someone who did not toil for it. This also is vanity and a great evil. What is a man from all the toil and striving of heart with which he toils beneath the sun? For all his days are full of sorrow, and his work is a vexation. Even in the night his heart does not rest. This also is vanity. There is nothing better for a person that he should eat and drink and find enjoyment in his toil. This also I saw is from the hand of God. For apart from him, who can eat or who can have enjoyment? But to the one who pleases him, God has given wisdom and knowledge and joy. But to the sinner, he has given the business of gathering and collecting, only to give to the one who pleases God. This also is vanity and a striving after the wind. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading is from Colossians chapter 3. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you: sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming. In these you too once walked, when you were living in them. But now you must put them all away: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices, and put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge after the image of its creator. Here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise. Gospel according to St. Luke, the 12th chapter. Someone in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Man, who made me a judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take care and be on your guard against all covetousness. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." And he told them a parable, saying, "The land of a rich man produced plentifully, and he thought to himself, 'What shall I do? For I have nowhere to store my crops.' And he said, 'I will do this. I will tear down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'Fool, this night your soul is required of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be?' So is the one who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God." This is the gospel of the Lord. We confess together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there
Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Voices raised to you, we offer. It talks about singing. It talks about singing of Christ, in Christ and through Christ, who is the song of love incarnate, the one who touches earth with heaven's grace, for Christ living, for his suffering, dying, for his rising. Hear our praise. And it was beautiful to hear your praise this morning. To hear, as Sarah just sang a moment ago, my heart ever faithful. Faith, one definition of faith that I think is so helpful, especially for us as Christians, is faith is honesty about dependence. And the honesty about dependence is that we are completely dependent on Jesus. Jesus, who we can only sing in and through the Holy Spirit, flaming through creation, kindling faith within our hearts, sustaining that faith, lifting our voices high in chorus, that Jesus is near, but it is only by the Holy Spirit that we can confess and trust that Jesus is near. The song that Sarah sang, though, it says this, it says, "My Jesus is near." And it is true, it is Sarah's Jesus, but it is also Evelyn's Jesus and Greg's Jesus. It's Linda's Jesus. It's Charlotte's Jesus. Your Jesus. Jesus, the one who is intimately connected to you, who has claimed you, who is covered over you in water and word. You're covered with the blood of Christ. You're baptized into Christ. And so you can say, "I am his, and yes, he is mine. He is ours." It is honesty about dependence. But it is a blessed assurance and dependence that we sing again and again and again. Last week I talked about the concept, and it happens every week, every day really, of lex orandi, lex credendi. I know you've probably got that written down in your notes. Yeah, I remember that. The law of belief is the law of prayer, the law of belief. That the things that not only we pray, but hymns are our prayers in song form quite often. The things that we pray reinforce the things that we do. They should. The things that we think and say should come out in our actions, and in turn, our actions should be consistent and reinforce the things that we say and think. And music has a way of reinforcing that, of confessing what is true and real. And the beauty in the church is there's nothing more real than this. This is the center of reality. This is the real world, and everything else is seen in light of this, in light of Jesus. But if I had to tell you about the song track that goes through my mind, and it's all jumbled together in a lot of different things, I wish I could say that one of the first top five songs on my playlist is "My Heart Ever Faithful, My Jesus Is Near." But when I was thinking about this text assigned for today, the gospel lesson about, it's called the parable of the rich fool, the song that came to mind for me, especially when it has to do with being rich, is a song that was during my formative years. I was 12 years old, October, November of 1989. It was the R&B, I said trio last night, I repent of that, it's a duo, but you all knew that. It's by the group Calloway, and the song is called "I Wanna Be Rich." And the reason this is in my mind is, well, one, because at the end of the reading today, Jesus says, the one who lays up treasures for himself, who thinks it's all about himself, that person is a fool and is not rich toward God. Well, I want to be rich, and Calloway in 1989 told me, and the song can so quickly come back. The song goes like this, and some of you know it. I know you probably listen to it every day. Jeff Huntington knows it. "I want money, lots and lots of money. I want the pie in the sky. I want money, lots and lots of money. So don't be asking me why, because I want to be rich. Da, 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 da. I want to be rich." Pastor Luke, do the dance. Okay. I want to be rich for the love, peace, and happiness, because if I'm rich, if I got money, I've got love, I've got peace, I've got happiness, except, well, that's the lie that the old Troy believes, but it's a lie, and it's foolish to think that I could be rich if I have money, lots and lots of money. And you should ask me why you want to think that you're rich in that way, if that's my song of love. But the temptation, the question, the reality is we've got to put our focus somewhere. And in a few weeks ago, in Luke chapter 10, 38 to 42, it is Mary and Martha in this beautiful picture of discipleship where this blessed discipleship, Jesus says that Mary has chosen the better portion, the good portion, because she sits and receives. She listens to Jesus and he fills her up. He is the one thing needful. She is rich. She is overflowing in riches. And then last week, it was not only about listening to Jesus, but then it is also how do we talk to God and with God and through prayer. And we pray to God the Father, who is a God who is rich in mercy and grace, and he wants to give. And he gives and he gives and he gives. And that is part of the song of love that we sing, the amazing grace that has found us and holds on to us. And today then, we hear a little bit further into Luke chapter 12, where someone in the crowd comes to Jesus and they want him to be the arbitrator. They want him to decide because there has been a death and there's an inheritance, and he doesn't think it's fair. This man thinks that his brother should share the inheritance with him, and Jesus says, take care, be on guard, be aware against all covetousness. Covetous, maybe it's that greed that can never be satiated. You can never get enough. Because one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. So the one who ultimately lays up treasures for himself is not rich toward God. Rich toward God, it's a directional word, it's a relational word. So Jesus says, one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. Well, using that phrase or that turn of phrase, I'll ask you rhetorically, think about it for a few seconds. Take an inventory of your life. And of what does your life consist? Or we could say the proposition at the end. What does your life consist of? What are the things that you treasure, that you value, that you hold dear? The things that are your precious deposit that you guard? Are you rich? Well, the answer, I hope, of every person here baptized into Christ is, yes, I am rich beyond measure. I have Jesus, my priceless treasure. The second communion hymn today is near. You can't put a price on the value of knowing Jesus and in turn also being known by Jesus. You are baptized into Christ. You have an inheritance that cannot be stolen away, that is priceless. And so in light of that, also aspirationally, or if you have an ideal picture of the future, what do you want your life to consist of? So we go back into this text with the rich fool, and Jesus, in order to illustrate the point, he tells this parable, and he says, the land of a rich man, and he's rich in stuff, but he's got a poverty otherwise, it produced plentifully. And this rich fool, and notice here the conversation that he has, because it's not really a conversation. It's not a dialogue, words between multiple people, at least two. It's a monologue, a conversation with himself. And he thought to himself, what shall I do? For I have nowhere to store my crops. And he said, I will do this. I will tear down my barns, and I will build larger ones, and there I will store all of my grain and my goods. And then he goes on, and he gives some assurance to himself. He speaks to his own soul, and he says, I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods. You have ample goods laid up for many years. So relax, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. Eat, drink, and be merry. That's Dave Matthews Band. For tomorrow we die. See, this rich fool, who's anything but rich, but he is a fool, he has a poverty of relationships. See, life is meant to be lived in community. And faith, then, beautifully and blessedly, is honesty about dependence. Like, we are dependent on one another. And this guy has no one to consult with, either because he's selfish and he just doesn't want to, and other people, they don't know anything anyway, or he just doesn't have anybody else to turn to. And so he turns to himself. He reassures himself. Hey, self, it'll be okay. But in the end, the truth will be revealed, and he is a fool. He doesn't have a good life. In the end, he has no life. The reality is that there's this term that someone is independently wealthy. Well, no one is independently wealthy. This guy, by all definitions, and if we called him, just a fictional character, Bill Gates, who owns half the farmland around in the United States, not independently wealthy, still completely dependent. Faith is honesty about dependence. And the truth is, if I look only toward myself and into myself and ask myself, hey, Troy, what do you think about that? Well, Troy will give Troy answers that Troy likes to hear. It's fun to talk about myself in the third person. But if we're honest, if we only look into ourselves, we'll see that we are destined to die. I didn't bring it up here, but the cover of the News and Notes there has a drawing by the artist Edward Riowas. It was covered up because Pastor Luke thought it was explicit graphic material because it has a skeleton on it. Scary. I think it's honest, though. The guy... The guy is a fool. He is destined to die, and I think it's not an accident that Riowas has the guy's thumb pointing back to himself, because he just checks with himself. And if you draw a line through that thumb, through his body, he ends up dead, a skeleton, alone. We're not here to tell ourselves that it's going to be okay. We're here to be reminded about this blessed assurance, about our heart ever faithful that sings of Jesus, the song of love, that he is near. He is near even to those who have gone down to the pit. The Psalms sing of this. In Psalm 49, right in the middle today, it says, honestly, this is the path of those who have foolish confidence, yet after them, people approve of their boast. So that sounds pretty good. Give that a like or whatever on TikTok or something like that. But it says, honestly, like sheep, they are appointed for Sheol, for the place of the dead. And who shall be their shepherd but death itself? That is foolish. But the beauty, the honesty of faith about dependence. But the psalm says, but God will ransom my soul from the power of Sheol. He will receive me. Honesty about dependence. Lex orandi, lex credendi. The things, the law of prayer and worship and song and speech reinforces and is the law of belief. All of life, we pray without ceasing. All of life is worship, not just confined to this space, but fed and nourished and then sent out into the world. Faith is honesty about dependence in every single aspect of life. And certainly at the end of our earthly life as Christians, this is what we confess at a funeral. It was just on Friday that we had my grandma's funeral, and it was all about Jesus. The focus ultimately was not on grandma's body, because in the service, her body, her casket was covered with a pall, which reinforces that she is covered and hidden in Christ. That was the epistle lesson today. It's actually an Easter lesson from Colossians chapter 3. If you then have been raised with Christ, then seek the things that are above, where Christ is. Your focus is on Christ, who is seated at the right hand of God. He is in control of all things. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth, because he is your new or constant identity and reality. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God, safe and secure. My grandma right now, she is hidden with Christ in God, covered over with the robe of Christ's righteousness that covers all her sin. And so are you. And when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will appear with him also in glory. So the focus always is not ultimately on you or me, and what I've done or you've done, but it's on Jesus. He is the living word. He is the Logos. It's not meant to be a monologue. It's meant to be a dialogue, a conversation in and through Christ. It's proclaimed in the church. The church militant, where we are gathered today, sitting together in the pew, joined with the church triumphant, those saints who have gone before, it is all about Jesus. It is about relationship. That is why, scripturally, in our guiding statement here at St. John, cultivating Christ's community through courageous discipleship and compassionate action, cultivation, growth, Christ's community, not our community. But it takes courage to follow Jesus, to live by faith when it at times can seem, well, it's definitely countercultural at times, and also maybe counterintuitive. But the truth is, we are not here to cultivate or grow a financial portfolio. We're not here to build a fortress with gates that are impenetrable. This is Christ's community, fed and nourished and sent out into the world. And the reality is, though, and I know this as I live it out firsthand because I'm an only child, and as I said that last night, well, I'm not really an only child. And that's antithetical to being a Christian. Well, it's just me and Jesus. I'm God's child. Sorry about the rest of you. But the truth is, at my worst, I live still my whole life like I am an only child. And it is a problem because covetousness and greed and stuff, I like stuff. Now, I'm getting better at trying not to hold on to it so tightly, but I still really like stuff. And other people mess my stuff up. And whether it is something as small as most recently Oliver breaking the handle to the toilet and I kind of lost it about that. I mean, it's probably an $8 part that I need to fix. But right now, just in order to deal with the consequences, everyone that uses that toilet in particular, including Piper's friends who spent the night last night, you have to lift up the porcelain and reach in and pull up the thing. That's just, hey, that's the consequence. You're going to mess around and break the toilet, we're going to live with it for a while. But I wish I could say that was the worst, because I had a pretty nice, and some of you maybe remember this, and not much has changed since probably 5 years ago when I brought it up the first time, pretty good collection of Matchbox cars and Hot Wheels, pristine. And because I'm an only child, nobody else messed them up. And I took them out, all pieces accounted for, all of them go back. And then, as we're blessed with a son, and Oliver was 2 or 3 years old, you know what Andrea says? Might be a cool idea. She's a third born. Might be a cool idea to play with those Matchbox cars with Oliver. We tried. And, I mean, no sooner are they out, and he's banging them together. He's got them in his mouth. He's running them through water. The axles are bent. I am slowly taking them out and putting them in my sock drawer and hiding them in other places. And finally, out of frustration, because Oliver is messing my stuff up, they are all packed up now and stuck in the basement. I don't know where they are, and I don't care, but at least Oliver isn't messing them up. I mean, aren't they really cool? Real blessing to have those Matchbox cars. And see, the stuff, I realize, I mean, it's stupid on the one hand. Like, the stuff that God gives us is meant to, I think, enhance relationships. It's meant to be shared. But as soon as I start trusting other people with it, sharing it, well, you're messing it up. I can't do any of that. That's why if you do come to our house, do not use crushed ice, because I have not put a water softener thing or filter on the dispenser, and there will be water spots, and that will mess up my stuff. I'm not even sure if you actually should use the refrigerator. In fact, maybe just wait outside. I'll bring you something. See, it doesn't stop. It doesn't ever stop for me. I need Jesus. And the thing is, my stuff can get in the way of my relationships. And instead of enhancing my relationships, it taints my relationships. And I am miserable. And I am not. I have a poverty. Not just of Matchbox cars and a broken flusher on my toilet, but a poverty of relationships at my worst. I don't want to be alone. But that's where I leave myself. But at the end of this today, where this rich fool who just has this monologue and reassures himself, hey, self, it's going to be okay, which is a lie. But God says to him, fool, this night your soul is required of you, and the things that you have prepared, whose will they be? Well, they're not going to be yours. And so is the one who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. Rich toward God, relational, honesty about dependence. So how do we seek to be rich toward God, to have a life that not just in theory but in action is a confession of the reality of grace overflowing, that Jesus is near to us, and when he is near, there is nothing that we need to fear. Because further down in Luke chapter 12, Jesus says, after don't be anxious about your stuff, he says, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure. He delights in giving you the kingdom. So sell your possessions and give to the needy. Provide yourselves with money bags that do not grow old, with a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches and no moth destroys, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Well, in this book by Mark Allen Powell, which is actually Pastor Luke's book, he's not an only child, so he loaned it to me. He's not worried if I mess it up. I've been trying to keep it pretty pristine, but he loaned it to me. A few years ago, I was listening to a sermon by one of our seminary professors, Dr. Jeff Gibbs, and he was preaching on this text, and he says he had done a book review on this book, and he said, well, Mark Allen Powell says in this book that if you want to love God more, give away more of your money. Well, that's a pretty cool statement, and Gibbs said it, and I trust him, so if you don't like it, blame Jeff Gibbs. But I believe it to be true. If you want to love God more, give away more of your money. Now, the idea here that Mark Allen Powell gets to in loving Jesus is he says that when Jesus says, for where your treasure is, there will be your heart also, he says, well, you can hear it as command, like, look out. Your treasure's here, that's where your heart is. But he says, you can hear that as a command, but you could also maybe hear it as a promise, as something that is aspirational and ideal. That's the true of our guiding statement here at St. John, cultivating Christ's community through courageous discipleship and compassionate action. Some people hear that and say, that's not who we are. Well, no, because we're always a work in progress. Sometimes we are cultivating discord and disharmony, and the smaller the thing to get people upset, the better. Whether it's where to put flowers or what to do with the basement or any number of other things. No, we are centered in Christ. It is about cultivating community. Well, so Mark Allen Powell says, for where your treasure is, there will be your heart also. He says, if you hear this as a promise, maybe you hear it this way. Where you put your treasure, that's where your heart will go. Where you put your treasure, that's where your heart will go. Well, so at my worst, if I just treasure my Matchbox cars and keeping them pristine, I shove them down in the basement, I know nothing about that, and they're of no use to anyone, and that's where my heart goes. But maybe if I put my treasure in, actually it's good to be with other people and share things with them, and if it gets messed up, so what, it gets messed up, but at least I have these memories with my son. So he says, essentially, your heart follows where you put your focus, and where our focus, I hope this is Christian church, is on Jesus, the crucified and risen one. He says here in this book on page 141, if you want to follow along or get this, every child, you haven't read this book yet, so listen up. Every child of God, he says, has a spiritual need to take some of his or her material possessions each and every week and get rid of them. He says, most pastors know this to be true, though they have a hard time talking about it. But here's the reality. People who do not give regularly of their money or are not healthy spiritually, and people who do not increase their giving regularly are not growing spiritually. Of course, and let's be honest, there are all kinds of caveats and exceptions to this general rule. Sometimes you suffer financial setbacks, people who feel moved to give to causes other than their local church, and so on. But no one, no minister or anyone else, should ever judge the heart of any individual based on this or any other external standard. There are many factors involved. But he says, I offer this only as a matter for your own conscience, for your personal consideration. And here's that quote. As a general rule, if you want to love God more, start giving away more of your money. You could give it to the church, and then I could buy new Matchbox cars to replace my broken ones. No, you just give it somewhere. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be, Jesus said. It's a promise, not a requirement, but a promise. So what we do with our money, and what's even more precious than money is time, it does affect how deeply and how purely we love God, and in turn are able to love other people. It was St. Ambrose, an early church father, who said of this rich fool, he said, he didn't need to build up those barns to store his wealth. He had plenty of places he could have put it. He could have put it into the mouths of the poor, and it would have fed and nourished them, and it would have cultivated life rather than contributed to the rich fool's death. And maybe in some sense, yeah, it's counterintuitive. So if you want to love God more, give away more of your money, more of your stuff. Live by faith, honesty about dependence. It's the way of discipleship. It's the law of prayer, the law of belief. It is a simple consistency, an integrity, a oneness, that when Jesus is near, not only there is nothing to fear, we have the one thing needful. And seeing ourselves and then others in Christ, everything else comes into focus. There is nothing to be anxious about. It's all taken care of. And you can't take it with you because your treasure is imperishable. It's the one who put on the imperishable. It's the one who takes mortality and puts on immortality and doesn't keep it or hoard it for himself or stick it in a box in the basement, but he shares it with you because he is his Father's Son and he gives again and again and again. And he gives to you and me again today, and not only through word but also through sacrament as he gives us his body and blood. You are rich, brothers and sisters in Christ. We are rich beyond measure because Jesus is near. Amen. And now may the peace that passes understanding guard and keep our hearts and minds in Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. I invite you to stand as we join together in singing the offertory.
Continue worship at this time by gathering our tithes and offerings. We welcome you to St. John this day and ask you to fill out the attendance cards and place those cards in the offering plate. And also, as we prepare to receive the Lord's Supper here in a few moments, we invite you to take a look at our communion statement and then news and notes. We gather our offerings. Please rise. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. All is vanity, O Lord, without the grace of your word and spirit. Guard our hearts against pride and arrogance and a life rich in things but poor in spirit. Grant to us wise hearts that we may love rightly all that you have made and use them for your purpose and glory. Lord, in your mercy, grant that in our lives together we may show the love of Christ to one another. Give all husbands and wives fidelity to their vows and promises. Help all parents teach their children to know and love the Lord. Guide all single adults that they might find fulfillment in the service to others. We rejoice with those who are celebrating anniversaries, especially Michael and Laura Collins and Doug and Charlotte Falconi. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, kingdoms rise and fall and leaders are raised up and brought low by your will. Grant our nation and its leaders humility before you, that we might recognize the vanity of all our plans and so be ready to rejoice and give thanks for your every good gift in the days that you give us under the sun. We also lift up to you all who serve in our military, and we especially pray for Alden and Garrett as they train at West Point. Lord, in your mercy, be near to the suffering, the dying, and the grieving. We especially lift up to you those being treated for cancer, Dick, Karen, Larry, Kathy, Jim, Tom, Paul, Nancy, and Rebecca, and those with other health concerns. We thank you for the recovery you have given to Tony and Arlene. We also lift up to you Jean Moeller, the mother of Leslie Huntington's, as she enters hospice care. Be with these and all others whom we name in our hearts at this time. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, you have seated your Christ at your right hand and surround him with all those that he has led out of the great tribulation. We thank you for the peace and rest that you have given them in him. We pray that you would one day deliver us by your hand into paradise that he has won for us. And this week, we especially join with Kathy Simpson in remembering John. Lord, in your mercy, answer all doubt and fear, O Lord, with confidence in your word and sacraments, that by these means of grace, we may be kept in holiness and guarded from temptation and despair until the day when you bring all things to their perfect fulfillment, and we are delivered to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is
truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who having created all things, took on human flesh and was born of the Virgin Mary. For our sake he died on the cross and rose from the dead to put an end to death, thus fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father.
Thank you.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he gave thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he gave thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
to body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you both in body and soul today to life everlasting. Depart in his joy and peace. Amen. Please rise. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good.
And his mercy endures forever.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.